More than 200,000 visitors come to Stones River Battlefield each year. It would be hard to overstate its importance to Murfreesboro and MTSU. On this edition of our program, we take a look at the multifaceted relationship of the university and the battlefield. Our first stop is an ordinary-looking field that played an extraordinary part in Civil War history. John Lynch has more.
It was hot and muggy the day we shot this video near Stones River Battlefield. MTSU students and faculty were joined by a group of dedicated volunteers to conduct an archaeological survey before commercial development covered over the site. In late December 1862, the weather was much different. It was rainy, cold, and the actions that occurred on this field helped change the course of American history.
This victory gives a huge boost to Northern morale at a time that it probably needed it most in the war, and it also helps support the Emancipation Proclamation, which, as luck would have it, goes into effect on the middle day of the battle. And that, of course, is going to change the whole tenor. We are no longer fighting a war after January 1st, 1863, simply to restore the Union. Now it's becoming actually about remaking the United States, and this is a big part of that. You know, most of us know the Battle of Stones River begins on December 31st, but if you're to poll men in Seals Brigade, which is actually just in, just to the east of the Harding House, it's going to serve essentially as their field hospital during the battle. You know, we have some, with all historical archaeology, you have some preconceptions of what you hope to find because you're kind of working not with just what's in the ground, but also you have a historical written record, maps, and stuff like that for us to work with. So we expected to find some things that would either support or maybe change what we thought we knew about what happened in the vicinity of the Harding House during the fighting on December 31st. Of course, our main plan, anything we found would be great because, as we all know, that land, about 100 acres down there is slated to basically become parking lots and office park. And although in a perfect world, the Park Service would have loved to have incorporated that into the battlefield park here, this is, I guess, the best thing we can do given the circumstances.
Indiana Jones adds sizzle to archaeology with his trademark fedora and bullwhip. Dr. Tom Nolan takes a different approach. He's managed to combine geography with archaeology in ways that would have been unimaginable in Indiana Jones' day.
One of the major attractions or major reasons for tourism in these sites is frequently people had relatives who served in the Civil War and perhaps were even killed in battle. And many of them come back to these places to sort of see where their relatives fought and perhaps died. This gives us a way that if someone had a relative, say, that served in Sheridan's division in the 42nd Illinois, for instance, and knew that they'd been killed, we can plot and take them within 25 or 30 feet of the area where that regiment fought at that particular time of the battle. So regardless of how this landscape changes, whatever's built here, they can still go back and find that site. And that, for many people, is a very powerful and emotional experience.
Assisting Nolan in the survey was Zada Law, archaeologist and geosciences adjunct professor.
Now, what's different about what we're doing that archaeologists don't always do is that we have GPS units with us, that we are taking the locations of the artifacts where they are on the ground as we find them. So, I know you think of archaeologists as gridding areas out and carefully piece plotting every location of every artifact. Well, we're doing that, but we're doing that in a real-time way. We're taking the locations from a series of satellites and we're able to get an accuracy of, less than 1 foot.
Well, what we'll do, is once all the satellites are hooked up to it and we find an artifact, we'll punch in create. It'll create a new artifact number, which will go into the catalog and will be recorded. And then as soon as it's done recording, We'll make sure that that point is marked and we'll move on to the next one.
We have some metal fragments that we found off this battlefield site. Possible shell fragments, maybe some farm tools and some iron pieces thus far.
I'm recording the artifacts as they're found, and you know, they find those artifacts, but we will catalog those, so hopefully these can be identified later and can hopefully and tell us about troop positions and what type of artifacts that were here. Will tell us a lot more about the battle. But this is a volunteer effort. A lot of these people are coming from a pretty good distance to help out with this project.
Well, I'm the treasurer of the Middle Tennessee Metal Detecting Club, and we set it up, or they contacted us to perform the hunt or help on the hunt for them. So I came up for that. Yeah, there was a few bullets found. I found one bullet, and that's about it.